Yes, we do.
Excellent, thank you very much. So good afternoon, everyone. My name is Mihai Bilauca. I am the Lighthouse City Coordinator for Smart Limerick. Smart Limerick is one of the Lighthouse Cities in the City Exchange program. And I would like to start by, first of all, thanking the organizers for the opportunity to share some of our insights into how we access energy data and our experience to date. And at the same time, I would like to thank the City of Derry for the invitation to take part in this very valuable workshop. It's a sign that in Ireland, we don't collaborate just between local regions like Derry and Donegal, but also all the smart cities in Ireland collaborate in something called the All Ireland Smart Cities Forum. And Derry has been a founding member of that forum since its beginning 5 years ago. So the opportunities to learn from city to city in Ireland are extensive. And today is probably another example of our good collaboration with the City of Derry. So CityxChange is a Lighthouse Smart Cities program. We have partners follower cities in Spain, Czech Republic, Romania, Bulgaria, and Estonia, and we are working very closely with our partner Lighthouse City Trondheim in Norway. So the two Lighthouse cities, Trondheim and Limerick, are working together to identify solutions for the creation of positive energy blocks and positive energy cities, districts, and obviously cities afterwards. Just for our international participants, Limerick is on the west coast of Ireland, is Ireland's third largest city. At national level, we are supported by the National Planning Framework, which sees cities as the main drivers of economic development for the regions. So we speak about city regions, and in order for us to accelerate the development of the city region, we want to take advantage of digital technologies, and we want to use technology. We want to use the power of data. We want to use new a process and new ways of collaboration and engagement with the citizens in order to create and support something that we call the Limerick 2030 Economic and Spatial Plan. And because we want to support this economic plan, we developed the digital strategy for Limerick, which sets the foundation for the smart city region. The strategy has 10 programs, 125 projects, 50 million euro to start with, and it involves creating new systems, new processes, and new ways of collaboration. And in this context, the Lighthouse City has the Lighthouse City project has been initiated and is being implemented. In the Lighthouse City, what we're trying to do is we're trying to create positive energy blocks, that is blocks of buildings of at least 15,000 square meters that create more energy than they consume. And to do this, we're looking at integration of renewable energy sources into buildings, obviously building retrofitting and trying to make the buildings more energy efficient, but also the integration of e-mobility and mobility solutions into the block. However, we know that this is not just a technology type of project. And we knew right from the beginning that we need to prototype, we need to be able to model and plan the city in a better way. We need to be able to obviously implement technological solutions that allow us to implement our plans and to reach our objectives. But most importantly, people play an important role to accelerate the path, accelerate the development of the city into a positive energy city. So community engagement and influencing citizen behavior is a key element of what we're trying to do. For us, people come before technology, they come before organizations, they come before anything else. And we believe that the idea of creating positive energy cities eventually will come simply through a different citizen behavior and people's behavior, which we focus quite a lot in this process. However, people's behavior cannot be changed unless we have a good understanding of what is the current behavior, what are the first, what are the issues, what data do we have around presenting the current behavior to people, to organizations living in the city. This is why we established something called the digital quarter. And in this digital quarter, we have picked up three building blocks to work with to try to create these positive energy blocks. And as you can see in this diagram, we have started to map out the energy profile of the city block by block and hoping to create a digital twin model of the city. We are fortunate in one way because Limerick is a Georgian city, at least its core is a Georgian city. And we have taken the challenge of creating positive energy blocks in a historical city center, which is very challenging if you think about it, because we believe that this is the real challenge that European cities have. It's not about creating positive energy blocks and buildings in brand new buildings, but rather in historical city centers. This challenge is valid for a lot more cities, not just Limerick. The advantage that we have by being a Georgian city is that the Limerick city has a grid structure, a block structure, which is very facilitates very easy replication, because most of the buildings in this block will be of similar types. There will be Georgian buildings. So we do have an office building called Gardens International, which is a Leeds Gold building, but we also have a old post office and three other Georgian buildings, such as the Rooney Auctioneers office, the Limerick Chamber of Commerce, the Youth Services. And in order for us to be able to create and add renewable energy sources in this block, we are planning to capture the flow of the Shannon River, which goes right to the city center. We are planning to install a tidal turbine that has been designed and developed by a local Limerick-based company called G-Kinetic. And obviously this additional energy that's going to come from the river that goes right to the city center will then be utilized to create this positive energy balance. Obviously, we'll be looking at providing information around energy consumption and energy generation in the city center and to the public. And we will be working with a e-mobility partner to look at the impact that e-vehicles will have on the city. Obviously, as I said, we are working with Georgian buildings, and one of the first things we started to do, we started to model the energy profile, but also the environmental profile of a Georgian building. And the reason we are looking at Georgian buildings is because they are so similar in the city center, all of them. And we believe that by understanding the energy profile and the environmental profile of one building, we should be able to replicate that across the city to a wider number of buildings. But the entire data that we produce as part of this exercise needs to be shared between partners, needs to be enabled. People need to be enabled to have access to this data. And we did hear from Piri that data and energy data is locked by default. And I think energy data is locked by default in every single jurisdiction in Europe. However, we need to open this data up and we need to share it between ourselves. And that's why, at least at the consortium level, we need to start thinking, how do we create a decentralized enterprise architecture model where data is being shared between partners without creating a central database, a single point of failure, and also kind of an aggregation point. And we believe that a decentralized enterprise architecture facilitates the creation of new services between all the partners. I know this is a bad diagram because there's a lot of detail, but what you see in the pink boxes is the number of partners that we have in working in Limerick. We have 17 partners from 11 countries working together, and we all want to be able to access that data, share that data, and provide insights to our citizens on, and obviously business owners know how to change their behavior and obviously access new services. Our new enterprise architecture is all about services. So while we do have the typical, you know, data sources and technologies and databases, what we are adding in this enterprise architecture is the idea of a decentralized service architecture as opposed to a centralized typical enterprise architecture and organization. And when we define this architecture, we have to take into account the various, stakeholder perspectives. We need to take into account privacy and trust issues. We need to look at ownership and access, policies and regulations. And obviously, from a data point of view, what are the interoperability requirements? What are the data security, the data governance, who is in charge of that? How we make sure that the data is being controlled and processed according to the legislation. We all want to use data. We all want to take advantage from having access to data, but we need to do that in a transparent, in an open, and obviously by being compliant with data protection legislation. So let's move on from conceptual into more practical lessons that we learned in CityxChange. At the moment, because we do want to have live data from our buildings, we have started looking at a LoRaWAN testbed. And what is LoRaWAN? It is a radio-based technology that allows small amount of data to be sent between buildings and a cloud provider. And that is very helpful because if you take the situation of a city, you have probably 1,000 buildings within a 1 to 2 kilometers radius. And in that case, this type of technology is very, very helpful in terms of collecting data from thousands of sensors and concentrating it into a platform. And without huge costs, the costs are minimal versus any other type of technologies such as, Wi-Fi or 3G and 4G. And what this LoRaWAN testbed that we have built facilitates is data to be sent from devices to gateways, from gateways to a concentrator in the network called the Things Network. That's what we're using at the moment just for test. And the data from the Things Network is then sent into a dashboard and analytics platform that allows us to look at that data. So if I'm going to show you how this looks in practice in reality, first of all, we start with sensors. And this is where in the left corner, you see a single phase energy sensor that is placed on at the entrance into a building. And obviously for larger setups, larger customers, we are using a three-phase sensor. And these sensors are sending data to a LoRaWAN gateway, which then sends the data into eventually a data analytics platform. And we're looking at this analytics dashboard, and we are able to see live data coming from the sensors in the test buildings. This is an example of the dashboard that I showed you earlier. And what you can see that we have in single place, both the energy consumption in watts, also the current in amperes. But on the right-hand side, you can see environmental factors such as the temperature, the humidity, the illumination factors, because you know if it's darker outside, obviously more energy is needed. Like now, I have my bulbs switched on. The air quality in terms of carbon dioxide, the atmospheric pressure, and other factors such as air quality. And this is possible because we have these sensors. This is a photograph here that I have where the sensor is placed just outside the meter, and that is centrally sending the data using LoRaWAN, and is sending that data from the LoRaWAN gateway to a dashboard and aggregator using REST APIs. However, in order for us to be able to capitalize on this data, we need to be aware of what are the enablers that will facilitate us to take advantage of having access to this data. So the first thing is, let's make sure we all understand what is the enterprise architecture. What is this distributed API-based model? And if partners provide the data, we need to have data contracts, because otherwise we cannot create services by relying on open data or by relying on data that nobody guarantees that we can build something and offer an SLA to a potential customer. So we do need to have data contracts. In the CityxChange project, because there are so many partners that will be processing at some stage data from the city, we implemented something called a data processing policy. And this policy has been signed by all partners. And in the terms and conditions of this policy, we agreed that we'll be transparent, that will be open, that will use the data only for the purposes of CityxChange project and only for the needs justified by the CityxChange project. And one of the first steps that we've taken in order to make sure that the people of Limerick have trust in the way we process data is to do a data protection impact assessment. And if I'm going to speak about this data protection impact assessment, which has been a very, very interesting process, we have used the guidelines provided by the expert group around the regulatory recommendations for privacy, data protection, and cybersecurity in the smart grid environment. And this document was published, even though it started in 2012, the latest version of the document was September 2018. And it is a very clear guide on how you go about running a data protection impact assessment in order to assess the risk of processing data across multiple partners and multiple services. And the first step was a pre-assessment. In the second step, we had to take a decision whether we initiate this data protection impact assessment or not. And the decision was to initiate because we do plan to process energy data that belongs to individuals or to individual families, not just organizations. The step three was to do an analysis of the use cases that will be involved in collecting and processing data, the assessment of threats, obviously a risk assessment from a data protection point of view, how are we going to mitigate that risk, and obviously document this DPIA report. The DPIA, the Data Protection Impact Assessment, is not a final document. It has to be reviewed because things change all the time. We decided to review it on an annual basis. And what was interesting in this impact assessment was that there are 11 categories of risks that have been identified, and overall 66 risks in total. The important part about doing a DPIA is not that you are assessing the risk, but rather you think of how you are going to protect people's interest as you process energy data. So what are the lessons that we've learned? The lesson that we learned is eliminate the distractor and focus on the business need. Focus on creating services for people. The second one is obviously there's no energy data available whatsoever anywhere. And I believe, and we believe, that we need to have a change in regulations, because our National Statistics Office collect data about almost everything and anything. However, we do not have energy data available, not necessarily at the building level, but also at statistical area level. We need to have a lot more information on how the energy is consumed and produced, we believe, in order to be able to really facilitate the transition to the energy market and fight climate change. It's another lesson is it's good to have a good enterprise architecture that everybody understands how systems, processes, actors interact with each other, exchange data, and build new services. Very important. Right from the beginning, establish a data governance structure. So it is very clear who needs to do what in terms of processing data. Of course, we have a consortium agreement, and the consortium agreement establishes the relationships between partners. But we need to make sure that the people of Limerick understand how the various partners work with each other in processing this data. And one of the key elements of establishing the data governance structure is to agree data principles. And that is documented in a data processing policy. Obviously, with this data processing policy, we run this data protection impact assessments in order to establish trust in what we are going to do in this project, and make sure we're open, we are accountable, and we use a transparent approach. And let's keep in mind that this project and whatever we do in the Lighthouse Smart Cities project should not be about anything else. than about people and the way they see the projects and the way they see that we have their interest at heart in whatever we do. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mihai, for this comprehensive and interesting presentation. And now again, we have some time for questions. So if anybody of you has any questions, don't hesitate. I think Leo has written down something, so I will give him the floor.
Things I was thinking about, you mentioned there that no energy data is available and there needs to be a change in the legislation. What do you mean by a change in the legislation?
We are looking at various interventions from a planning point of view. And we found out two situations. We have a utility a regulator, which should establish how data is being published, collected and published in Ireland. We started to believe that if for example, the Central Statistics Office collects data about jobs, unemployment, computer usage, computer access, and so on, why aren't they collecting energy data in a similar way? Why is that data in the ownership of the DSO and nobody else knows where, how much do we consume? How are we as local authorities supposed to plan for fighting climate change where access to the most important asset is restricted? We have a regulator that I believe should enforce on the DSOs, especially when it's no longer a state-controlled market, should impose the need to publish aggregated data like the way, and not just part of themselves, but rather as part of the central statistics exercise. You know, I mean, we have a CSO in place. Why aren't we asking for that data to be made available at regional, city, district, or small area, statistical area level?
Yeah, we have a similar sort of problem in Northern Ireland at the NESRA, which would be the equivalent to the Northern Ireland equivalent of what you say is collects data. As you say, they collect data on housing, they collect data on public health, they collect data on health, various different things. But again, they don't collect data on energy as well. So we have a similar problem here in Northern Ireland that you have in the South.
Yeah, but I think we have a similar problem across Europe. We've no access to data and we tend to do nothing about it. Probably because the energy sector was state controlled for a long time. However, this is a decentralized sector. The private operators should be made present aggregated data at statistical area level as part of the National Statistics Office, not as part of because they want to or because they don't want to. Made, do it.
Simple. I agree.
Simple. That's why we have a regulator to regulate.
I guess, yeah. And how, for example, the GDPR affected this availability? I guess it even worsened it, or?
Of course, we're not asking the regulator to ask personal data to be published, but data aggregated at small statistical area office has no GDPR implications whatsoever. Like we have a lot more sensitive data, such as migration status collected at small statistical area office, but we don't have energy data. And we are in the climate, climate risk at the moment, you know?
Yeah, so it's not very well adapted with European objectives, I would say. Well,
I totally agree, as I mentioned in my presentation too, but one more other question. How do you see in big buildings IoT sensors role compared to building management system connected sensor role?
I think the building management systems should take on board the IoT sensors in order for them to be more adaptable and more modular. I believe that the IoT is now going through a maturity phase. I think the BIMs will in fact rely on IoT going forward.
Yeah, and one more question about the IoT sensors. You mentioned LoRaWAN. What do you think, Sigfox or narrowband IoT?
They are all very helpful. However, there are costs. The narrowband IoT could be expensive. You have the price of a SIM. You have challenges with the SIM. And you also have the SIMs going in lockdown more from time to time. Sigfox also, it's a nice network to use. It's very useful for particular use cases, but it can be expensive. So from location to location, I think a different technology, communications technology needs to be adopted. LoRaWAN is not a solution for everything either, but from depending on the use case, a different communications technology needs to be adopted, obviously, if the business case indicates financial value.
And we have another question from the audience, from Juanita Blue. Do you think smart infrastructure will improve the availability of aggregated energy data?
I believe that will happen if the regulator imposes that data, statistical data, it should be made available. And secondly, if the regulator establishes a standard for how the data should be published. We know that the commercial sectors will always try to confuse how data is being published in order to gain a competitive advantage. I think commercial sector should be enabled to gain a competitive advantage, but not at the disadvantage of the citizen, by keeping us in the dark. That shouldn't be on at all.
Thank you again for a very nice response. Let's wait, let's say 30 seconds to see if there is any other question. And
Marit here from Tampere. May I have a question? The data you are collecting, do you have some kind of a standard data model which you are using for sharing the data or using the data?
We are building this as we speak. We are in the middle of creating that standard. We are only 1 year into the project.
So are you going to use some already existing standard, or are you making your data model your own, or how you plan to do it?
If there is one, we'll try to adopt a national, an international standard. In fact, I am a contributor to ISO standards, and I will try to seek the knowledge of my colleagues and my peers that look at international standards for energy data exchange. So we will go for international standard if it exists. I don't have that knowledge at this stage. But if that doesn't exist, we'll try to look at European level. If that is at international level, look at European level. And if it doesn't exist, I'll try not to create one for Limerick, but rather to create one that other people can contribute to that.
Okay, yeah, because we are also at the similar point in Tampere that we are planning the IoT platform, and we need to figure out what are the standards to use for the data models, how to share the data.
I think if one doesn't exist, I haven't researched the topic yet, but if one standard doesn't exist, we should create one collaboratively as opposed to one for Limerick and one for Tampere and so on.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah, we are actually looking for at least the fireware architecture. I don't know if you have taken that into account or planning to use that. It's still limited, but at least we have been working together with Tampere University of Technology, and they are creating new data models for that architecture.
Fireware is a very powerful set of methodologies, if I can put it that way. We'll definitely consider Fireware in what we do. We are obviously, we are a member of the Open Agile Smart Cities Network. We are members of a couple of international networks that look at standardization, and we'll continue our efforts to standardize and to help the standardization efforts, both in Europe and internationally. We want to make a contribution. We don't want to reinvent the wheel.
Yeah. Us too. Thank you.
And we have a follow-up question from Juanita Blue. How can we fix the problem with the regulator?
engage, simple, just engage, explain. And regulators, we found the Irish regulator to be extremely, extremely helpful and open. I think we should not have this, preconception that, oh, the public sector doesn't do their jobs. And, you know, we should break that because we found the regulator in Ireland to be extremely, extremely helpful. It's a matter of working with people.
So there should be more communication and interaction between the different.
Absolutely. Yeah. Just work with the regulator. They're very open. In Ireland, they're very open. We've met the commissioner, and we have their full support and attention. I think we are all in this.
I think they wanted
just
to say
one thing, just to to add to that. I don't know if you'll find this useful, but we have regular Positive Limerick meetings amongst all the partners involved in our work package 4. And anytime a regulatory issue comes up, we actually invite the regulator to our meeting. So we're really trying to involve them in the project as we go. And we find that helps build trust with them.
Oh, that's great, yeah. I'm not sure if this is possible in every country, but...
But our commissioner for the regulation of utilities have actually assigned a team to work with us in the Lighthouse City, you know, to work with us to understand what challenges we have and what solutions might be there available.
All right. I mean, it's important to have them on board and talk to them regularly.
Yeah, so engage. Collaboration. Collaboration is always good, you know.
And smart cities are all about that.
We cannot hear. I cannot hear anything.
Ah, yeah, sorry. It's because I switched myself off. So, yeah, I guess there are no other questions.
One more question related city data. Would it be good start that every city could open their public building related energy data?
Of course they should be. And I think every public building in itself, not just public building, but any organization should just open up their data to make a contribution to the population's knowledge in terms of how energy is being consumed. In fact, our plan is to just put these sensors in council buildings, even though they're not part of the PEP that we are creating. Just publish the data, put the sensors in council buildings, look at the energy profile, energy consumption, try to influence the behavior of our own colleagues before we start doing it in the community. So I'm a big adept of do it yourself before you try to go out there and try to get others to do it. Lead. I think councils have an important role here to lead that transformation, to lead the understanding of the energy consumption and how the behavior of employees can be changed or influenced to lead towards a more efficient energy use.
Marek, yeah, at least in Helsinki in Finland, they have opened the energy consumption data for all public buildings.
That's excellent. I think that's an excellent idea.
Yeah, so we need to follow them.
Yeah,
that's the reason why I ask.
Definitely.
Somebody else? No? In that case, thank you very much, Mihai, for all these contributions and to everybody for the questions.
And thank you for having us.
Thank you very much for joining, because I know that now with the COVID, etc., and there's quite a lot of workload. So thank you for making the time and joining us today.
It's our pleasure. And especially working with the sister project such as Stardust, it's our pleasure.
Thank you very much. Yeah. And if any time you can contribute as well to some of your activities, do not hesitate to contact us. And
definitely, I would like to work with you in terms of the standards that have been mentioned earlier. Definitely interested in that.
I think that would be...
Let's keep in touch.
Yes.
Limerick,
I didn't get the name. I'm not sure who's talking. I don't see the name.
Marit Vehviläinen from Tampere.
Hi, Marit. Nice to meet you. I think I've met you probably...
We have met in Barcelona.
And in Brussels.
And Barcelona. I think in the Nordic, there was Well, there was one event with all the coordinators and project managers.
Yes, now I remember. Yeah. But I recognize the name, but I don't see the face. Okay.
Yes.
I see you again.
Yes.
Let's begin.
Yeah.
Bye-bye.